Welcome, welcome, welcome. It's the Legal Lounge here on CRN Digital Talk Radio, crntalk.com, streaming live coast to coast and around the world on crntalk.com, also available in stunning high-definition video on facebook.com/crntalk. Also on CRN's custom-built Roku channel. You can find us in the Roku application store, also on Tiki Live, and of course on crntalk.com. I am joined, as always, by the one and the only, an active attorney, U.S. Army vet, Juris Doctorate in Law, undergraduate degree in physics, and author of a book that has proven to be a guideline for the Supreme Court now and in the future. That book, American Illusion of Freedom, is available on Amazon, Barnes & Noble, and on iTunes. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Richard Nixon, sir, how are you?
Thank you very much, Mike, for those kudos. It's interesting, when I wrote that book, it was written in criticism of the Supreme Court because of all the, if you will, erroneous decisions, at least from the standpoint of a strict constructionist as I am. And now, as it turns out, with the way things have happened here with President Trump and his appointment of the last three Supreme Court justices, it looks like they're, if you will, of the same mind I am, and it looks like they might be correcting some of those errors. So now, my book, rather than looking at it as a source of criticism of the Supreme Court, it can more or less be looked at as a guidepost for what I think the Supreme Court will do in the future. That's another reason to buy my book.
Absolutely. So maybe also we should start planning for an addendum, a second volume, or maybe the title will be America. Maybe we're on the right track, at least when it comes to the Supreme
Absolutely.
Court.
And if we do that, I think you'll probably be a co-author because of your knowledge that you've gained during this program.
Well, I appreciate that. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
I will definitely contribute to maybe a book jacket. Like that. All right, Richard, so we got a lot to talk about. Let's start with an article that you pointed out to me. And
yes.
This has to do with a national figure. This is Governor Ron DeSantis of Florida, who is become quite popular in Republican circles. And this has to do with wokeness. And I feel that perhaps I should define what wokeness is.
Please.
Before we get started, and we're definitely going to continue talking about this in the second segment, but as people know who've listened to this show, I've received a liberal arts public education, so wokeness was definitely a part of that. Definition is an alert to injustice in society, especially racism. Colloquially, you hear people use, we need to stay angry and stay woke, or this person is woke and whatnot. And Governor DeSantis, last year, he signed a piece of legislation which also passed both houses of the Florida State Legislature called the Stop Woke Activism and Critical Race Theory in Schools Act. Recently, a Florida court struck portions of that law down. We're going to talk about that. But Richard, we got about 30 seconds before we hit the first break. Are you woke?
I am not woke because, as I understand woke, it has to do with critical race theory, which is the absolute opposite of what Martin Luther King Jr. Professed or taught, and that is that you judge people by the not by their color of their skin, but the nature of their character. This is an about face on that, and basically says all white people are racist, and they know they are, and only people of color, if you will, deserve any merit.
We're going to talk more about that right after the break. Of course, the latest in the Maralago raid and more here in the Legal Lounge. Stay with us.
What are you going to do with your old car? You can try selling it, you could junk it, or you could donate it to Heritage for the Blind. Your car will be towed away for free, and your donation is tax deductible. Just call 1-800-785-9618. Heritage for the Blind accepts cars, vans, trucks, and boats. It doesn't matter if your vehicle runs or not. It will be towed away for free, and you'll be supporting those that need help. Heritage for the Blind is a nonprofit organization that helps the visually impaired live fuller lives. Call right now to donate your car, and as a special thank you for calling, you'll receive a free 3-day vacation voucher to many exciting locations. Call Heritage for the Blind right now, 1-800-785-9618. Donating is easy, and your vehicle is towed away for free. Plus, you'll get a free vacation voucher. Call now, 1-800-785-9618. That's 1-800-785-9618.
And We are back in the Legal Lounge here on Digital Talk Radio, CRNTalk.com. As always, all previous sessions are available on YouTube. Also, as a podcast, CRNTalk.com/podcaster. Find Richard's folder there. And we're talking about this article that Richard pointed out to me. This is from the Daily Journal, the legal paper of record out here on the West Coast. This article is titled, "It's No Surprise That Florida's Anti-Woke Law Violates Freedom of Speech." Richard, what are your thoughts on this article?
Well, my problem with this article is that Mr. Attorney Leonard Lonnie Zilberman, his parents were from Russia. They were allowed to leave. And when they left, because they were Jewish, they left under certain circumstances. And his position is, in this article at least, that he is pro First Amendment, regardless of, I guess, whatever anybody wants to say. So when Mr. DeSantis and the state of Florida passed some legislation called Stop the Woke Act, he was gratified or happy to see that a federal judge ruled that that was unconstitutional, basically unconstitutionally vague. In other words, that the judge claimed that the employers and so on did not know what they could do or not do. And therefore, he is, if you will, happy to see that the woke idea will prevail.
Yes, this legislation, the Stop Woke Act, which was passed by the Florida legislature and signed by Governor Ron DeSantis, it was subject to review from the federal courts, the District Court of Northern District of Florida. The case is honeyfund.com versus DeSantis, and Judge Walker, the presiding judge in that case, ruled, quote, "It is unclear what is prohibited by this law and even less clear what is permitted." He also, Mr. Walker, Judge Walker said, quote, "Imagine an employer during a mandatory seminar on dispute resolution cites the civil disobedience exemplified by Martin Luther King Jr. and Mahatma Gandhi as peaceful preferred approach. Has that employer incalculated employees with the belief that black and Asian people are morally superior to white people?" Of course, the answer is a resounding no. That's directly from the decision. One thing that is kind of interesting to me that first jumped out when you brought this article to my attention is Mr. Zilberman's CV. Lonnie, as he's known colloquially, practices employment law, diversity, equity, and inclusion, as well as mediation and alternative dispute resolution, and provides, and this is the key point, folks, and provides anti-harassment and other employment-related training to California employers. What the Stop Woke Law would have done, Richard,
correct,
is it would have stopped employers over that have over 15 employees from bringing in people like Mr. Zilberman, whose job it is to teach these, you know, woke kind of, you know, HR stuff. Everybody sat through the HR stuff where it's like, you know, you have to be inclusive, all this, blah, 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 blah.
Right.
Mr. DeSantis didn't want that, along with CRT and public schools. And Mr. Lonnie here is just like, well, I mean, if this ever comes here to California, that means a big part of my income's gone.
Yes. And there's a number of serious flaws in the ambiguity of this article, because, first of all, he does not necessarily connect what he does with the woke or anti-woke systems. You have to really read through it and draw certain conclusions between things. But he's basically, what he's arguing basically is that he teaches anti-discrimination, diversity, equity, and inclusion. Now, that all sounds good, except that's simply a cover for what the actual woke people do teach, and what I said is it's the opposite of what Martin Luther King taught, and that is that some people are superior to others based upon their color. The other thing he does is he very vaguely and generally discusses the First Amendment, that everything he doesn't like the stop woke now idea because it goes against the First Amendment. However, he's never read it. Well, we have, and we're going to recite what the First Amendment actually says here now. This is 1791, Article 1, First Amendment, which says, "Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof or abridging the freedom of speech or of the press, etc." Now, we've said this many times on this show, and that is, it's clear that Article 1 is only addressing the federal government. It's basically saying that we, the people of the 13 colonies that wrote the Article I, the First Amendment, are saying we've given the federal government, this behemoth or this monster, certain powers. However, they do not have the power to make law regarding freedom of speech and freedom of press. Now, it says nothing about the states having a similar prohibition or limitation. The states properly understood and hopefully consistent with what our present SCOTUS will believe and rule is that there's nothing wrong with Ron DeSantis in the state of Florida or any other state from limiting free speech. If they want to limit free speech, especially to children, that does not teach that one race is superior to another, in other words, that woke is prohibited, there's absolutely nothing wrong with that, assuming that we go by what the original Constitution intended.
The reason why, the First Amendment, like you said, Congress shall make no law.
Right.
If the framers intended the Bill of Rights to be incorporated to the states,
right,
they would have included language thereof.
That's right. They would have said neither the federal government nor the states can make laws, etc.
Mm-hmm.
But you got to remember that it was the states who wrote this thing. The states created this, if you will, quotation, monster, this big federal government, which a number of them had reluctance to do in the first place. But having created the federal government in 1789, in 1791, 2 years later, they decided, we've got to start limiting this federal government. So it's obvious that they did not intend to limit themselves. They were intended to only limit the federal government, which they had just recently created.
So Mr. DeSantis, he can, because this was just through a district court,
right,
he can now go through the appellate process and perhaps take this to the Supreme Court.
I believe so. And, of course, we I think in our show prep we talked about the fact that something like 20 out of 30 school district school boards have now anti-woke people on the board.
And those boards are all elected.
Yes.
And so Mr. DeSantis could go to a court and make a pretty cogent argument saying the will of the people is saying that we want, you know, this anti-woke legislation,
right,
or something close to it. To because, folks, this is democratically passed both houses of legislature and signed,
right,
by the governor.
Right. And again, this gives more impetus for our position that for suggesting that the book that I've written and the posture of this show, we've always been anti-Second Amendment to the extent that the...
Anti-First Amendment, that is.
Anti-First Amendment to the extent that it applies to the states, same with the Second Amendment. And the point is, because of the incorporation doctrine, it's been applied to the states, but we'll go through that mechanism if we have time later. But the point is, it makes my book, if you will, and this show even more relevant now.
Absolutely. And that book, American Illusion of Freedom, is available at Amazon.com, Barnes & Noble, and on iTunes. So make sure to check it out. We'll be right back right after the break. You guys stay with us.
Have you heard about vine-to-bar chocolate? It's the winemaker's chocolate, the world's first chocolate made with well-vined Chardonnay marc from the beautiful coastal vineyards of North America. Gently pressed grapes are harvested after juicing, dried and finely milled and carefully blended into the finest dark chocolate. The Chardonnay marc contains highly beneficial grape nutrients, flavanols, and has a natural sweetness that flavors the luscious dark chocolate. Mouthwatering, flavorful, delectable dark chocolate goodness with Chardonnay sweetness and beneficial nutrients. And it's alcohol-free, too. It's vine-to-bar chocolate. Order some today at vine-to-bar.com. That's vinetobar.com. Cold ship to your door, it's Vine to Bar. Vine to Bar Chocolate. Visit us at vinetobar.com.
This is a potter's field. When people can't pay for their funerals, they are buried here. It is a lonely, desolate place. littered with unmarked headstones. No one visits. No one leaves flowers. But it doesn't have to be that way. For as low as $1 a day, you can ensure your family will have the money to pay your funeral expenses. We offer burial insurance plans that pay up to $30,000. Considering the average funeral costs more than $10,000, that's peace of mind for your family. There are no medical exams, your rates won't increase, and your policy cannot be canceled as long as you make your premium payments. Call now to get approved in minutes and ensure your final resting place is more than just a pauper's grave in a potter's field.
800-305-9102. 800-305-9102. 800-305-9102. That's 800-305-9102. Paid for by Final Expense Direct.
Is your bathroom looking old and worn out? Want to update it, but you don't know where to start? Then let VCI Bath & Shower show you how to turn that old bath into an aisle of beauty and functionality. Our residential bathroom solutions provide the best value on the market, and our customer service is second to none. Our cost-effective VCI Bath & Shower family of products has what you need.
Remodeling our bathroom was a big decision for us.
They didn't make a mess out of our house at all. And at the end of the day, we had a beautiful new bathroom. And it was a great experience the whole way through.
We have the best monthly payment programs in the industry, with payments as low as $68 per month or no interest, no payments for 18 months. That's right. Get the bathroom of your dreams now and pay for it in 2022. Call 1-800-455-7923 for a free, no-obligation price quote. That's 1-800-455-7923. When you want quality bathroom products at a great price, it's got to be BCI Bath & Shower. That's 1-800-455-7923.
And we are back in the Legal Lounge. Just to tease something for next week, we're going to definitely discuss Governor Newsom's plan to ban all gas-powered sales of new vehicles in 2035. So stick around next week for that.
Yes.
But of course, we have to get into, Richard, the news of the week, which is more about the fallout from the Maralago, the unprecedented raid of President Trump's private residence in Maralago. And the affidavit, the heavily redacted affidavit, was released on Friday. And some key takeaways of the affidavit: it is heavily redacted, including pretty much anything to do pertaining with the probable cause.
Yes.
And so the jury, the mystery still abounds with that. But agents, according to reporting from The Hill, agents believe Maralago housed more classified documents and evidence of obstruction. The unredacted portions of the affidavit made this conclusion plain. There's a probable cause to believe that the additional documents that contain classified or that were presidential records subject to record retention requirements currently remain on the premises at Mar-a-Lago, which the agent states in the affidavit. Also, the extensive redactions leave, like I said, the probable cause out. And also, the affidavit indicates that the National Archives first reached out to President Trump and his staff about retrieving records as early as May 6th. Just a few months after Trump left office, but it wasn't until December that Trump's team indicated it had boxes of documents ready to pick up. Your thoughts about the affidavit, the released redacted affidavit, and where we're going moving forward with this?
Well, case. Even before the affidavit, you have the warrant itself, and the warrant itself described several things. But again, under the Fourth Amendment, and let me find it here real fast, the Fourth Amendment basically says the right of the people to be secure in their persons, houses, papers, and effects against unreasonable searches and seizures shall not be violated, and no warrant shall issue but upon probable cause supported by oath or affirmation, and particularly describing the place to be searched and the persons or things to be seized. Now, there are those who are arguing, of course, on the Trump side, and I frankly, I agree with them, is part of the warrant basically says, okay, you're authorized to pick up A, B, and all other things, basically. So it lacks the specificity or particularity that Article 4 demands, and therefore, I think there's a good case to be made that the warrant itself was improperly granted by this judge. The other problem with this judge, I think, is research reveals that Judge Reinhardt was involved in another case between Trump and the Clintons. I'm not sure whether it was Mr. or Mrs. Clinton. He recused himself in that case, and people are suggesting he should have done that in this case. However, we don't know the facts. We don't know the basis upon which he recused himself. Possibly he recused himself having to do with the Clintons rather than having to do with Mr. Trump. So there are a number of open-ended cases. We won't know much more about this. At least looks like 90% of it was redacted. We don't know much. Right now it's speculation and conjecture among all the experts.
And this Judge Reinhardt, he's a magistrate judge, he's not an Article III judge. What's an Article III judge?
Well, an Article III judge is a judge that is part of the Constitution, and he is appointed by the president and
confirmed by the
Supreme Court, by the Senate. What he is he's basically appointed by other trial judges, if you will, district judges, and he, in this particular case, does not have jurisdiction over felonies. He does have jurisdiction over warrants, so theoretically he could make the decisions that he made. However, as I said, he probably should have recused himself because if he doesn't, it's important for judges to realize, and people know this, most judges know this, it doesn't matter if you have any real bias. It's the appearance of bias that counts. And that's what you've got here, that it looks like this judge was handpicked because he is probably anti-Trump, and that is not what we should be doing.
So he can't try felon. So he's kind of, and I don't mean to be unkind to Judge Reinhardt, and he's had a rough go of it recently. He's actually in hiding right now because of death threats, but he's kind of like a notary almost. I mean, he just kind of signs warrants and applications, but he doesn't actually, you know, preside over felony cases.
Well, it's the same as the person who's claiming that Mr. Trump did not return these documents. This person, the archivist, is nothing more but a glorified librarian.
Yeah.
So it's the same thing. We give them nice euphemistic titles as though they're really and that's really the argument here.
Well, President Trump, he says that due to his power as commander-in-chief, he can declassify any documents at any time.
Absolutely.
Without even really any documentation. We're going to talk about the legal arguments behind that position right after the break. Maybe Google the unitary executive theory and Mr. John Yoo. Stick around. We'll be right back.
Fred Dreyer here for the product I use and love, Balance7.com. Are you suffering with heartburn? Get relief from Balance 7. You know, most people are able to go back to eating the foods they enjoy with Balance 7. Please don't be stubborn. This really works. You're just a sip away from enjoying the foods you like. Try Balance 7 with a money-back guarantee. Are you experiencing fatigue and brain fog? So many people complain that in the afternoon, their energy seems to disappear and the brain becomes foggy. Balance 7 neutralizes the acids in your body. This aids your digestion. The energy from food is more effective, and afternoon brain fog fades away. Balance 7 is the answer. Go to balance7.com or call 800-793-9039. That's 800-793-9039. Mention the code word FRED and get $10 off your order. Call 800-793-9039 and mention the code word FRED. Get heartburn relief and more with my favorite, balance7.com.
Do you want to fly somewhere, anywhere in the world? Smart travelers call myflightsearch.com for the best deals on flight tickets. Going to Manila, Bangkok, London, how about Singapore? Call myflightsearch.com for the lowest flight tickets available. What about a local vacation? Let's say you want to fly to Vegas, Orlando, Miami, Los Angeles, or Denver. Pick up the phone and call myflightsearch.com right now. We have exclusive deals that you can't find anywhere else. The only way you can get these low airline prices is by calling us. We have so many low prices available, we can't possibly tell them to you right here and now. If you're flying somewhere anytime in the next 6 months and you want the lowest airline ticket prices anywhere, you owe it to yourself to save a ton of money. So pick up your cell phone and call myflightsearch.com right now.
Call 800-445-3166. 800-445-3166. That's 800-445-3166. Call now. 800-445-3166.
Hi, this is Fred Dreyer talking about my favorite Italian restaurant, Angelo's and Vinci's at 550 North Harbor Boulevard in downtown Fullerton. A fantastic place to eat. Come inside and dine in our Italian town square, complete with a 10-foot Christmas tree. That's right, 10 feet. Enjoy our food made from secret family recipes. Pasta, chicken, seafood, salads, and our delicious pizza. Incredible desserts, including my favorite, the tiramisu, flown directly in from Italy. Feel the spirit at Angelo and Vinci's, 550 North Harbor Boulevard in Fullerton, California. Call 714-879-4022 or visit angelosandvincis.com. That's angelosandvincis.com.
Let's talk about your credit cards. When you first start using them, it's a slow drip. You make charges, then more charges, then bills come, and they keep coming. When you open your statements, the floodgates come pouring in. You realize you have more credit card debt than you can afford, and you're barely making the minimum payments. Wouldn't it be nice to make one affordable payment and have all your credit card bills covered? Make this free call and learn our responsible way to get your credit card bills paid and under control.
Sponsored by Consumer Education Services, a nonprofit organization.
800-876-3643. 800-876-3643. 800-876-3643. That's 800-876-3643.
CESI is not a loan company. The establishment of a debt management plan may adversely affect your credit rating. Non-payment of debt may lead creditors to increase finance and other charges to undertake collection activity, including liquidation.
And we are back in the Legal Lounge, CRN Digital Talk Radio, CRNTalk.com, talking about unprecedented raid at Mar-a-Lago and just the issues surrounding thereof. A friend of the show, Alan Dershowitz, he went on Fox News and he actually said something interesting. He made news on Fox News saying that he believes that the government has enough evidence to indict the former president.
Yes.
On charges regarding the Espionage Act and the Presidential Records Act as well. But he kind of, his comments have been taken out of context by a lot of media organizations. If you read his full quote, says, quote, "The other important thing is," this is the full quote, "there is enough evidence here to indict Trump, but Trump will not be indicted in my view because the evidence does not pass what I call the Nixon-Clinton standards. The Nixon standard is the case has to be so overwhelmingly strong that even Republicans support it. And the Clinton standard is, why is this case more serious than the Clinton case when there wasn't a criminal prosecution?" I mean, the Clinton case, going back to 1998, the Monica Lewinsky affair, and full disclosure, one of my really good friends dated her.
Absolutely.
Also, it should be noted, too, I mean, the President Clinton was accused of providing false statements for obstruction of justice and coercing witnesses to lie, and he was not prosecuted.
Correct. I mean, it's rampant. Everyone knows, anyone who pays attention knows that our judicial branches, FBI and the Justice Department, or some would call it the Injustice Department, are biased toward the Democrats and have been for some time. There's some, I understand that Mr. Mark Zuckerberg, who's apparently the head of the CEO of the Facebook institution, basically said that he was approached before the 2020 election and told that the Hunter Biden laptop was just more Russian disinformation and to ignore it and not to use it. And he followed suit. He obeyed what the FBI had suggested or told him or ordered him. And some people are saying that that interfered with the election. And had the Hunter Biden laptop been discussed before the election would have gone further toward Mr. Trump.
Yeah, quite. Yeah, absolutely. But a former law clerk of Justice Samuel Alito
Yes.
He presented a pretty interesting and cogent argument about Mr. Trump's assertion that the president, as commander-in-chief, can't declassify materials based on his discretion at any time and any place.
Yes.
And this particular clerk of Mr. Alito cited two particular cases just briefly. One is Department of Navy versus Egan, and another one had to do with Judicial Watch versus Clinton. The Egan one is interesting, and like we've talked about before, the law is more art than science.
Correct.
And that the goal of an attorney is to make an argument that will be persuasive towards third parties.
Absolutely.
And this particular clerk says that in Egan, the crux of the case is that the grant of security clearance was a sensitive discretionary call committed by law to executive branch. Another case also, this is a fascinating case, actually, that goes back to the 50s. This is United States versus Reynolds. Some of the post Supreme Court and some of the scholarship surrounding this case says it's a well-established that the president is constitutionally charged with protecting information related to national security, as the Supreme Court has stated. The quote, the authority to protect such information falls upon the president at the head of the executive branch and commander-in-chief.
Right.
And so this clerk from Alito was saying that the presidential powers under Article 2, Section 2 give him this discretionary. Can you read from Article 2, Section 2?
Well, yes. There is a former clerk of Justice Gorsuch, Mike Davis, who basically quoted those same cases, Mike, and basically he's saying that the president cannot be cited for obstructing justice. He cannot be cited for espionage because he has the sole authority without anybody's approval to declare what is classified and what is not. And, of course, the Constitution says, Article 2, Section 2, Clause 1, that the president as commander-in-chief shall be the commander-in-chief of the Army and Navy of the United States and of the militia of the several states, etc. So in his role as commander-in-chief, his role or his authority is sole, and only he can determine what is classified and what is not. And therefore, this archivist, thank you. This archivist or a librarian, if you will, he's basically arguing, and the Justice Department is apparently agreeing with him, that Mr. Trump has some classified documents. Mr. Trump is saying, no, he does not. He's already unclassified or declassified them. Mr. Trump has some witness, apparently, to it, Mr. Cash Patel, who says he was there when Mr. Trump did this, when the boxes were all loaded up, and that Mr. Trump declassified all these documents. So it might turn out to be much ado about nothing, but it does stir up people who want to be anti-Trump will have something to argue about. They'll simply say Trump lied again, and there you go.
Well, I mean, let's play this hypo out a little bit further. For the Espionage Act itself, reading from the statute, the Espionage Act makes it illegal for anyone who has information related to national defense to use it to injure the United States or to the advantage of any foreign nation.
Yes.
Both of those claims have not been proven and no evidence have been supplanted there
right.
either.
Well, they haven't even been alleged. I mean, my point is, even if they find something in there that might lead to the definition of espionage, they would have to show that Mr. Trump took those documents or used those documents, gave them, if you will, to China or Russia or somebody like that with the intent to do damage to this country. The fact that he only has them, his possession of them, is meaningless. You need intent to harm.
Exactly. The first provision of the law, once again reading from the statute from the Espionage Act, states that someone must have intent or reason to believe the information would be used to harm a U.S. Defense could argue. And also, just devil's advocate, there is language in the statute that says that someone who lawfully possesses a document could violate the law if they permit it to be taken from its proper place through gross negligence.
Yes.
And we haven't seen any evidence of that either. We're going to talk a little bit more after the break, and then we're, of course, going to get to the student loan debt cancellation. Stick around, we'll be right back.
What are you going to do with your old car? You can try selling it, you could junk it, or you could donate it to Heritage for the Blind. Your car will be towed away for free, and your donation is tax deductible. Just call 1-800-785-9618. Heritage for the Blind accepts cars, vans, trucks, and boats. It doesn't matter if your vehicle runs or not. It will be towed away for free, and you'll be supporting those that need help. Heritage for the Blind is a nonprofit organization that helps the visually impaired live fuller lives. Call right now to donate your car, and as a special thank you for calling, you'll receive a free 3-day vacation voucher to many exciting locations. Call Heritage for the Blind right now, 1-800-785-9618. Donating is easy, and your vehicle is towed away for free. Plus, you'll get a free vacation voucher. Call now, 1-800-785-9618. That's 1-800-785-9618.
Have you heard about vine-to-bar chocolate? It's the winemaker's chocolate, the world's first chocolate made with well-vined Chardonnay marc. From the beautiful coastal vineyards of North America, gently pressed grapes are harvested after juicing, dried and finely milled and carefully blended into the finest dark chocolate. The Chardonnay marc contains highly beneficial grape nutrients, flavanols, and has a natural sweetness that flavors the luscious dark chocolate. Mouthwatering, flavorful, delectable dark chocolate goodness with Chardonnay sweetness and beneficial nutrients. And it's alcohol-free, too. It's vine-to-bar chocolate. Order some today at vine-to-bar.com. That's vinetobar.com. Cold ship to your door, it's Vine to Bar. Vine to Bar Chocolate. Visit us at vinetobar.com.
And we are back in the Legal Lounge, CRN Digital Talk Radio, CRNTalk.com. Just some breaking news. It just broke about five minutes ago as we were recording this show. Judge Eileen Cannon, a Trump appointee, has ordered, hasn't ordered yet, but she signals she's likely to back former President Trump's request for a Mar-a-Lago special master. In the brief order, Judge Eileen Cannon also orders DOJ to give Trump more details on what it seized from his state. And this more details thing sticks out to me because last week when we were going through the warrant itself, it did have a property catalog on
there. Yes, it did.
So I wonder if anything was omitted. Also, one thing we talked about before the show, Richard, that I think we should circle back to, which is important, about the Fourth Amendment,
right,
is they took the safe. They took the whole safe.
Right.
And you talked about particularity in the language of the Fourth Amendment.
Correct.
Wouldn't the contents of that safe, unless someone actually saw what was the contents of the safe?
Yes. Or unless some people have said someone actually opened the safe, and then they somehow, instead of removing the papers from the safe, they just took the, quote, opened safe with them. Now, maybe that makes sense for them to do that, but if it's closed up and they have no reason to believe that any of those papers are in that safe, they should have just left it there.
Because that would have violated the plain view doctrine, correct?
Absolutely.
Plain view doctrine, of course, is that if you are serving a search warrant on a person and if certain items or certain crimes not listed in that warrant are observed not in plain view, then that is exculpatory.
Absolutely.
All right. I got to be very careful about this next one that I don't curse on the air, because this one's got me very, very upset, Richard. This, of course, is the President Biden's unilateral plan. He's bypassing Congress and the courts to do this, though I think we both agree that this will wind up in the courts one day or another. He is canceling up to $10,000 of or up to a minimum of $10,000 to a maximum of $20,000 of student loan.
And you're angry
debt.
Why, Mike?
Because, Richard, I paid some tuition. I wrote some fat checks in my time.
Yes.
I remember, with the beginning of that semester when you had 7 days before after the semester started to have your financial issues
in order.
Taken care of, checks written.
Yep.
And I remember when I went back to school and got my degree, I specifically went to a public college because it's
correct.
Cheaper.
Correct.
A college that I commuted to because that's cheaper as well. And I was still out maybe about $30,000.
You did it the right way.
And I put it on my Amazon card.
Yes,
and then, you know, I managed to pay it off in about 2 years. And, you know, all I got was some lousy frequent flyer miles.
That's right. And see, you did it the right way and you suffered through it, if you will. And the fact that you have these degrees is well obvious. It's obvious you are an educated man, of course.
Well, I appreciate that, but I would like the $30,000 back.
And that's the problem with, I think, this program that Mr. Biden is professing, or maybe he's already signed, is there's no quid pro quo. Now, again, I have objection to it because I got my law degree courtesy of the GI Bill, which I appreciate and did appreciate. However, I gave up several years of my life and could have been, if you will, killed because I was in the military. And for that, the government rewarded me with a free education. I got my degree in law, and I'm very happy with that. However, these people there's no quid pro quo. They're simply forgiven these debts. I think that's wrong. It sends a wrong message to these young people that if you happen to be the right person at the right time, you get freebies.
Oh, I disagree, Richard. I think there's definitely some quid pro quo here. I think it's what Joe Biden is saying is like, hey, here's $10,000. And it should be noted too, not $10,000. It's it's $20,000 if you have Pell Grants. And
yes,
the restrictions here is if you are eligible for this loan forgiveness, $10,000 for regular loans, $20,000 for Pell Grants, if you make $125,000 a year or less.
Right.
That's a nice chunk of change.
Absolutely.
Also, fun fact, folks, if you are a joint filer and perhaps say you both have you and your spouse have loans, if you are joint filers and you make less than $250,000, a quarter of $1 million a year,
yes,
you also qualify this particular program.
Yes. And this is obviously what some people now call the Democratic Party as the giftocrats, where they simply purchase votes rather than going through common sense and deciding, because there are many Democrats who are up for election here come the end of this year, who are advising Mr. Biden not to do this. Now, it may be too late. And what's interesting, too, is that Ms. Pelosi is recorded to have said, I saw the video, that Mr. Biden cannot do that. He might be able to lessen or delay this, but he cannot excuse it or forgive these debts, and yet he's done it anyway.
My research staff, I saw that quote, I saw that video.
Yes.
But she tried to clean that up. She was asked about it yesterday. And she was in Las Vegas the other day. This was on Tuesday, last Tuesday. Pelosi said that she, quote, didn't know what authority the president had to do this. And
I
now
see.
clearly, Pelosi went on, it seems he has the authority too. So
I see.
She
I
said
see.
He doesn't
sure.
have the authority last year.
Yeah.
But once he does it, he's got the authority now.
Yes, well, you know, it's understanding that she's a little confused. Her husband got involved in an automobile accident. He was driving, I think. He paid $175,000 for his Porsche, smashed it up. He was guilty of, apparently he pled guilty to going through a stop sign and doing damage to his car. It's apparently totaled, and it hurt the other car, and I guess it did minor damage to the other occupants. But interestingly enough, I don't think he got any special favorite treatment because he pled guilty and he got the same treatment as everyone else.
We're going to talk more about this student loan and the inflationary reality right after the break. Stay with us.
Experiencing pain, back pain, shoulder, elbow, or hand pain from a sports injury? If so, schedule a visit with Dr. Michael Sheps, the leading expert in laser therapy for pain management. Call 310-873-4422 or go to drsheps.com. Experience Epic T, the breakthrough laser therapy system that Dr. Sheps developed to make you pain-free in less time. Laser therapy is a non-invasive, safe, and effective in-office procedure that penetrates deep into your skin without damaging the tissue. It perfectly targets areas of pain to promote fast, natural healing. Relax your muscles, ease muscle spasms, joint stiffness, and arthritis pain while increasing blood circulation. For over 25 years, Dr. Sheps has helped Olympic athletes and sports enthusiasts alike get back in the game. Schedule your visit with Dr. Sheps at his Brentwood office in California. Call 310-873-4422 or visit drsheps.com. That's drsheps.com, 310-873-4422.
What are you so happy about?
I'm on the pill.
Aren't you two a bit old to worry about having more kids?
Not her, me.
You lost me there, buddy.
Steel Man pills. Things weren't always looking up, if you catch my drift. So, my doctor prescribed me a little something.
Like Viagra?
Yeah, but that's expensive, and it wasn't covered by my insurance. Steel Man pills cost me less than $3 a pill, and virtually the same effect. I just called and got over 40 pills for only $99.
I have this friend who might be looking, and...
Well, if your friend want some help, the consultation is free over the phone. No clinic. Steel Man Pills sends it in the mail in a confidential package.
I'm on it. I mean, my friend will be on it.
Steel Man Pills. Going the extra mile to help men with erectile dysfunction.
800-605-1683. 800-605-1683. 800-605-1683. That's 800-605-1683.
When you really want Italian food, you have got to get to Colombo's. Colombo's Italian Steakhouse and Jazz Club. Colorado Boulevard, Eagle Rock. It's that little neighborhood place you wish was down the street from you. Today, it seems so hard to enjoy just a little bit of easy. So much of life seems to get in the way. But fear not, seekers of fabulous food and fun and thrill. Colombo's is Southern California's answer to Easy Street. Great grub with some of the finest steaks, the freshest fish awaiting for you to devour. Did I mention Colombo's family Italian recipes? Colombo's spaghetti bolognese, their chicken pesto ravioli, magnifico, and of course, the world's greatest meatballs. I can go on. But why go on when you can go on over to Colombo's and experience delicious and easy for yourself? Colombo's, of course, that little neighborhood place you wish was down the street from you. Colombo's, mangia bene.
And we are back in the Legal Lounge, Siren Digital Talk Radio, SirenTalk.com. As always, all previous sessions available on YouTube. You can find us on YouTube by searching for Siren Digital Talk. Find Richard's playlist, also a podcast. You can also find Richard's fantastic book, American Illusion of Freedom, available on Amazon.com, Barnes & Noble, and on iTunes. Okay, so I got through that last segment without cursing about this student loan debate, and I'll try to get through this one because this is the last segment we got. And so there's two issues we should discuss here. First, the legality about this. We talked about Mrs. Pelosi, who, you know, is having a hard time with her husband. You know that Porsche?
Yes.
Mr. Pelosi's Porsche?
Right.
It's up for auction right now.
I understand.
Yeah.
I understand.
So maybe that'd be a fun kind of collector's item right there.
Do we know what year it was or what is?
It was a 2020, I believe.
2020.
Yeah. It was an S, but it wasn't a 4S. So it's not as nice as yours.
Oh, I see.
Yeah, so up your game, Mr. Pelosi. Where does the president get authority for this? Because, of course, we mentioned in the last segment that Ms. Pelosi says that, you know, he doesn't have the authority, but now that he did it, he does have the authority.
Oh, yeah, sure.
And you brought this to my attention, Richard, that the authority that Mr. Biden says he is relying on to issue this unilateral order is through the 2003 HEROES Law.
Yes.
The 2003 HEROES Law was adopted overwhelming bipartisan support in 2003 at the times when U.S. forces were fighting two wars in Afghanistan and Iraq. Gives the education secretary authority to waive rules relating to student financial aid programs in times of war or national emergency.
Yeah, it's kind of like the GI Bill. Yeah,
exactly. Because this is right. We were in action in Iraq. We were in action in Afghanistan, and also a lot of people joined the military at that particular time because we were defending America, and so there's some implications there. So what Mr. Biden is doing is, if you read that language, it gives the education secretary authority to waive rules relating to student financial aid programs in time of war or national emergency.
Right.
So what Mr. Biden did is he's going off the declaration that Mr. Trump declared of a national emergency of COVID in 2020.
Right.
But Mr. Biden, I thought we were past COVID at this
yes,
point.
Yes. And what's the emergency here? And to tie it to somehow rewarding people for what? For getting sick? Or what's the connection between the emergency, that is COVID, and excusing this particular person for not having to pay his loan?
I guess the administration, what the administration would say is, well, you know, COVID affected the economy so much that people have a hard time getting jobs and therefore they can't pay back their student loans.
Correct.
I don't think that holds much water. But also, let's talk about the potential legal challenges here to this program. Are already certain advocacy groups are considering filing lawsuits. And this brings up the major questions doctrine. The major questions doctrine is the administration must point to clear congressional authorization when it inserts a new power over an important part of the economy.
Yeah, and I don't think they can do it. And, of course, the strongest argument that we have, I think, or at least those of us who oppose this, is that what about those people who did not choose to go to college? The electricians, the plumbers, the carpenters, et cetera, they had to spend time and money educating themselves to be proficient in their jobs. And now those people are now paying for these people who did go to college, who are probably going to end up being wealthier than the electrician, the plumber, and so on. So you've got the, if you will, poorer people, again, paying for the wealthier people, which is supposed to be the antithesis of what the Democrat Party stands for.
Only 35% of Americans have college degrees.
Okay.
65% of the population, the working population, does not have college degrees. And asking that 65% to pay for the college degrees of that 35% is antithetical to what I think this country is about.
And this is why the Democrat Party likes to pick favorites and so on. The Republican Party likes to do it in general. Reduce the taxes for everyone. And now that means that every person can now choose, because they have more money, more disposable income, they can now choose to go to college or not go to college, et cetera, have insurance or not, as opposed to the Democrat Party, again, picking favorites. We're going to allow you to go, and we're not going to charge you as much, or we're going to give you a rebate. That is simply, again, antithetical to the whole idea of democracy and the government taking or making special, picking their favorites.
Couldn't have said it better myself. We actually went into overtime for that.
I stumbled through it, but I got it.
All right, you guys. See you next week in the Legal Lounge. Take care.
In true CRN high definition audio, the difference is a